Welcome back to Retro Depot. I'm Doug. Today we're going to be taking a look at how you design a 8-bit computer. Had a guy post a comment to one of the videos asking me to do some tutorials on how you actually go through the design process. And it's fairly complex, very complex subject, I must say. The honest truth is, the design of a Z80 system, or even any 8-bit system, reality, it can take a very long time to do. It can take months, it can sometimes take years for them to really develop. If you look at a lot of the famous systems out there, you know, they didn't just pop up overnight. Nobody sat down and just decided, hey, I'm going to do this, and the next day they had a Z80. I mean, certainly there are some people that have made functional systems, but typically this takes a lot of time. Even my own G80 design, I would say that the learning curve was about a year of really learning the material about the Z80 in order to be able to understand how it worked, and, you know, looking at other people's builds and determining how you do that. And then it was probably another 6 months, you know, toying around with my original Z80 computer, the almost the not really a development board, but almost like a you know, Z80 learning computer, you know, to where I can plug in the data and then read it and, you know, have a couple output ports. And then it also took probably another 6 months to go from that to the G80S, which was the first Z80 beta board that I produced. Of course, shortly after that, I came out with the version 1.0, and then that eventually evolved into the USB, and now that's also evolving into kind of a new, you know, format. But what I'm getting at is it took years in order for me to get to that point. It wasn't overnight. I didn't learn it. I had no experience in technology. I'd messed around with some microcontrollers and things like that in the past, but I really didn't know anything about them. I didn't know anything about electronics before I actually sat down and started building the Z80 computer. A few fundamentals I knew where to look for, you know, for example, calculating the resistor values for LEDs and things like that, but I really didn't know a lot about them. So having said that, we're going to go through this. It's going to be mostly on the computer, but I anticipate this being over several episodes. It's going to be at least a second episode, but maybe even a third or fourth. So we're going to go through this. I'm going to show you some of the things that I do in designing these. And if you have any questions, like I said, feel free to drop them below. Other than that, I hope you enjoy the video, and we'll get right to it. So we're going to take a look at how you would go about designing a Z80 computer in this video. Now, we have Eagle pulled up here, and of course this is an older version of Eagle. I tend to prefer it over the newer versions for the simple reason of backwards compatibility. I know that anything I design in this is going to be able to be opened by this, so I've just kept this version. Now, the first thing that we want to do is we want to begin coming up with an idea as far as how we're going to put this computer together. And for the purpose of this demonstration, I decided to keep things simple. So what I've thought about doing is a very easy to build computer, something with a processor, some memory, and some very simple I/O. Now, I got to thinking about it. Not everybody is into Z80 trainers, so that kind of does away with that type of project. Most people want a computer that they can use for something else. And one of the most popular ways of using that computer for something else is to use, have some type of serial or video and keyboard interface, something along those lines. So I thought to myself, well, how difficult would it be to design a computer similar to what a couple other people have done with the use of a microprocessor as its I/O. So, you know, in an attempt to try this on my own, I decided, why not? So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to stick a frame in here. Now, if you don't know what a frame is, it just lays your schematic out with nice, neat borders and gives you some, you know, basic means of putting some information on the screen. So if you'll go into your add window, you'll type frame. And I'm actually going to use a A4 size frame, but I'm going to do a letterbox or a portrait, or not a portrait, letter. Yeah, you know what I mean. So I'm going to stick that there. And I'm not quite sure that's actually the right size. I think I probably want to go larger. Yeah, let's go larger. Let's go to A5. Actually, that's not even large enough. I think this will probably do us. Yeah. Okay. So now that we have this, we can zoom to fit. And I'm going to slide that over inside the window here. Now, the first thing that we need to do is begin adding our components. So we know that we're going to want to put a Z80 in here because it's the greatest 8-bit computer ever. I don't care what the 6502 fanboys say. Z80 or go home, baby. Nah, I'm just pulling your chain. It's a great processor, but it's not necessarily the best. It's really simple to use. So we're going to place that right there. And the next thing that we need is some RAM chips. So, delete that, and we are going to go down to, I think, the memory. Yeah, here we go, generic memory. And we're going to be looking for the tried and true 62256. I'm sure there's probably one in here somewhere. Although I may have to look for it for a little while. This is part of the fun, is finding devices. I think those are very similar. Yeah. But I don't like that footprint. We're going to try something else. We're going to go down to some of my parts that I've done. I'm not seeing anything there, but it's in the old. It's the SRAM narrow. Trying to figure out where you put all these chips is usually the hardest part. Now, technically, this will work, 28C256, because it has the same pinout. So, see if we can just type in 62256. Nothing. Try 32K. This will work. Make sure I don't have any that are pre-modified. Doesn't look like it. Okay, so we'll just use one of these. Alright. So we're going to want two of these. So we're going to put one here and what about there? Now, the first thing that we want to do is, because we don't like the format that we have here, we're going to go ahead and change the footprint. So we're going to open symbol. And we are going to go to the device, or the package rather, which is a 28-6. There we go. Now, the first thing that we're going to want to do is delete all the outline here. And now we're going to want to change all these pads. We're going to go with a round. It doesn't take long, but this gives us a little bit more uniform means of doing this. That way all of our ICs look exactly the same. And plus, I like this particular standard that I've come up with for my IC packages. It just makes it look nicer. And although it doesn't quite look as vintage, it just looks nicer. So we're about halfway done now. Doesn't take too long. Nope, not octagon. We want round. Now, with doing this, you can make this look however you want. You can use it the way it was. It really doesn't matter. I like the round pads because they give me a little bit more room on the board. These oval type pads, they take up a lot of room, so it's not something I really like too much. But it doesn't take long to go in here and fix all that. And of course the default settings for the size is okay. Now we're going to take this, we're going to make sure it's on T-place, and we're going to start right here at the line above and the line over, and we're just going to make ourselves a nice little box around it. And then we're going to come right down to the center and make our tab. So that is it for the IC. We're going to save that. It can't make a backup copy, and that's perfectly okay, but we're going to exit out. And now we are going to replace this. Now we have to remember which one it came out of, so it's going to be the LH52256. So we're going to replace LH52256, and that did not do it. Let's try our 32K again. Alright, so there we go. Now it's changed. We're going to go ahead and accept. It is going to update with a new version, and now we've changed that to meet our needs. Now the next thing that we need to do is we need to add some type of I.O. So what I've been thinking about for this, because I have many on hand, is to use a 18 mega 16. So we're going to go down here to Atmel. And if you don't have the Mega 16, the Mega 32 will do just fine. But here we go. So now we have the Mega 16. So that should work for us. Now again, we need to open the symbol. We need to open up the package, which this is going to be a 40 pin. Going to open it up, and we're going to do the same exact thing that we did before. Now, I'm going over this step, and you know, it's probably unneeded. So what I'm going to go ahead and do is I'm going to pause the video, and I'm going to go ahead and get this done, and then we will start this back where whenever I'm finished. Okay, so now we've gotten this done, and we're going to go ahead and save it, and then we're going to exit out of that, and again we are going to update or replace the footprint. So we're going to go into replace, and then we're going to go back to Atmel, and we're going to go down to 16P, and as we can see that footprint has changed, so we're going to go ahead and update it. Now, so we have our Z80, 64 kilobytes of RAM, and then we have the Mega 16 here. Now the reason why we're doing it this way is because, quite frankly, we really don't need any ROM. The reason for that being is because we can store the data within the 18 Mega and then use the 18 Mega to take control of the Z80 to load that information into the bus.
And in this series, we will be demonstrating how that is possible. So, in the meantime, we're just gonna go ahead and, essentially build this thing up from scratch, design it. I have no design pre-laid out, so this is just the base of the system. Now, the next thing that I do know is that I will need some type of way to signal the microprocessor that I'm trying to send data to it. Now, the easiest way to do this is to actually use a 74HC74. Now, this is a dual D-type positive flip-flop, and we are going to want this in a DIP package. So we can select that there, and it's going to have two. Now we want to rename the value on this because we're not planning on using LS parts. We're going to use HC or HCT. So we're just going to call this 74HC 74Ns. Now the next thing that we are going to need is going to be some resistors. So if we type resistor, rather, we get all these right here. Now, I always use the RCL package, and it has RCL US, and that's what we're going to be looking at. For this particular package, we're going to use the 20710s because that's just a good package to use. It's very old school. And we're going to need about, well, at least five or six of these, so we're going to stick a couple of these out here. Now that we have the basic components here, we need to have some way of clocking the computer. Now, there's a couple different ways to do this. You could use a regular crystal oscillator. You could use a clock oscillator, like a 4-pin, either a DIP 8 or a DIP 16. You could come up with some type of fancy clock circuit. It really doesn't matter too much. To be honest with you, we're not really going to need much of that. So, I just don't really see any purpose in coming up with something fancy. So, what we can probably do, and I think that we will have the ability to do it here, is to use a CAN oscillator, or I'm sorry, not a CAN oscillator, but either a 12 or a 16 megahertz crystal on the AT Mega 16, and then we will be able to actually feed that information or feed that clock back into the Z80 pin. I think that we should be able to do that. That should be a pretty good way of working this. So we're going to go ahead and do that now. And actually, no, before we do, we need to take care of some housekeeping here. So we're going to start a bus. I'm just going to start it about right here. We come on up and we're going to come on over to the edge because you never know how much you're going to need. Now, the first thing that you're going to want to do is you're going to want to begin naming this bus. So to do this, you just type in the names of the signals. So M1, MREQ, IORQ, read, write, refresh, halt, wait, NT, NMI, reset, bus request. That's going to be a very important pin for later. We have clock, ground, VCC. And then for the address and data pins, we're going to use A bracket 0 dot dot 15 in bracket. And for the data, it's going to be D bracket 0 dot dot 8. I'm sorry, 7. And then that is it. So now we can take these. So now we can take these pins here. If I can get this to work right, and we can connect them to the pins that we need them to connect to. And I always like to put a label there. You can use this little tool here to put a label. That way you know exactly what line that is. But probably want to add another bus line over here. We can actually connect that down here like so. So that way we can encapsulate these and have every area distinct. So now we're going to do mem request, IO request, read, write, refresh. And I'm just going to go on with this. It's nothing super exciting, so I'm going to go ahead and pause the video in order to not have you sit here and watch me do each one individually. And once I get all of these lines connected, I will come back and we'll take the next step. Okay, we are just about done. Now, one of the things that you can see is by using the name that I did for the bus, it's given me these options for D so that we have more than just, we don't necessarily have to type D0, D1, D2. We can just branch these out so that we can pick exactly which pin it is and have smaller windows there. But after we do that, we're just going to go in here and we're going to give this thing a little bit of room first off. And we're going to have to go back and clean these up. I'll do that real quick and then I'll start the video back up. Okay, so we've got the Z80 portion there done. The next thing that we need to do is work on these RAM chips. So I'm going to bring this bus back out. And I think that'll probably give us enough room there. We don't need a lot of room, we just need a little bit of room. So now we have it kind of centered, and we're going to go back in here and just start connecting all those lines again. But as you've noticed, probably, we've got an issue. We need a chip select line, pin 20 on both the SRAM and the, what would normally be a ROM, but we're going to be using two SRAMs, so this needs to have some type of connection to it. So what we can do is we can click the naming tool here. And we can bring this up, and if we hit right, we can put a comma in, and we can do RAM low, RAM high. So now, whenever we go to connect the chip enable pin, we can put it as either RAM low or RAM high. So we'll put this one RAM low, and we'll go ahead and put the name there, that way we know exactly which one it is. So I'm going to go through here and connect all of these nets and then attach the names to it. And whenever I'm done, I'll be back and we'll go from to the next step. Okay, so we're back, and I must admit I had a slight oversight. I had to go back and change out these two RAM chips. The issue was that they didn't have a quite right pinout for what we are needing to do. So I've changed them. They are a same capacity, the 32K, but they actually have the proper pinout for the standard 62-256. Those other ones, for some reason, it had the lower address pins mixed up for some reason. But we have those up, we have them done, so now we have put address lines between the Z80 and the RAM chips. However, we have made one mistake, and that is this line here. That should be A14, not A15. So we can correct that real quick. And we'll put up a tag there. Now, having said that, you're probably wondering, if you've never designed one of these before, what about A15? Well, A15 is the most significant bit that determines which chip that you're actually going to be addressing. So we need some way of actually interfacing to one chip or the other. Now, there's a couple different ways that you can do that. But the easiest way to do that would be to use a couple of logic ICs. So in this particular case, we are going to go back up to the 74 series logic, and we are going to want a 7404, which is a 6-channel NOT gate. And not seeing any HC parts, so we'll just grab a generic LS and we can rename it. But we want to make sure it's going to be a DIP package. So we're going to actually bring these right here. And we may not need all of these, but we might. It's hard to say. We can always have spares if we need to, though. Now what we want is a 74 LS32. And this is actually a trick that I learned from Z80.info. It's a very simple decoding scheme for breaking apart the 64 kilobytes into two sections of 32 kilobytes. So we're going to go ahead and get a LS32 in. And again, we won't need all of these, but we will need some. And this is a quad chip, so there's only four. Okay, now we're going to need to get a few of these moved out of the way. So we're just going to select those and move the group. We'll move it down here. And we actually don't need that many. We can actually do away with a lot of these if we need to. But we will need two of the ORs. Now, the easiest way to do this would be to try to position these in a way that you can make it come about logical. So we're going to put a line in here, and this is going to be A15. So we have A15 done like that, and we will put up a address line there. And then we are going to take this line and steal it to go over to pin one of this OR gate. And then we are going to take the lead from this, and we're going to bring it down and put it into there. And we will put up a little name here. And we are going to rename this to not A15, which gives us the opposite. Now, the next signal that we are going to need is going to be memory request. So we are going to put memory request in, and then we are going to attach to that, and we need to put a name there as well. Okay, so the basic way of understanding this, if you're going to try to simplify this, is if A15 is high, that means that we're trying to address the top 32K of the address space. But in order to do a chip select, we need an active low signal. So we know that we need this high, we know that we need memory request low in order to be able to access this chip, but we need a low signal in order to do it. So we're taking the A15 high, we're putting it through a NOT gate, which turns it into an A15 low, and we're combining that with the memory request low so that the output turns into the chip select for the high RAM chip, which we have named RAM High. Now, RAM high, and that was a little bit loud. I'm going to turn that down just a little bit. There we go. So, to go back to the logic here, high of A15 and a low of memory request will turn into a low, not A15, and a low memory request, meaning that the output of the OR gate will be high. Remember, an OR gate, if there's a high on either this pin or this pin, it will show a high on the output, and we need a low. So that's the reason why we nodded it. However, if the A15 is low and the memory request is low, we get two lows on the other OR gate, which gives us the output of a low for RAM low. And of course, we will rename this now. So that's how we figure out our entire memory decoding for this computer. Now, I'm going to actually take this entire area and I'm going to move it up because we don't want to waste space here. So we're going to take this and we're going to move the group up. And it looks like I'm going to have to move these individual lines up as well. There we go. So now we have a little bit more space to work here. And we can use this space to begin putting in our resistors. Now, we're just going to drop these up here, and we're going to go ahead and bring this bus on up so that we have a little bit of room to work with, and we're going to position these in a manner that's a little bit more reasonable. So I'm going to just begin dropping these like this. They don't have to necessarily all orient the same direction, but this is just an easy way of doing it. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to want to actually connect this line to VCC because we need to pull this up. And the reason why we pull this up is because on the Z80 itself, we have several pins that we need to actually pull high. For example, interrupt, also the non-maskable interrupt, the reset, the bus request line, and a couple others. So we're going to go ahead and do that at this time. And to do that, we're just going to take these signals and daisy chain them on over. So now we got highs. Now, we kind of need a method of determining exactly which pins it is that we need to pull high. So I'm going to pause the video for just a minute. Okay, so now I've got the information pulled up here for the Z80 pinout, and it's these input pins that we're worried about. It's going to be interrupt, non-maskable interrupt, reset, bus request, and wait. So that tells us that we need to actually address those pins. So we're going to go ahead and pull this back up, and we are going to basically just attach those pins to the signal. So it's wait, interrupt, non-maskable interrupt, bus request, and reset. Where is reset? There we go. All right. So we have those pins pulled up to high, and we can actually put some name tags in here. That way we know what we're working with. Looks like I'm going to have to move these up a little bit, which is a fairly simple task. Okay, and we can actually move this up a little bit as well, just to get it up out of the way. Do the same thing for these, just to pretty everything up. And there we have it. We have our memory decoding logic, and we have our pull-up resistors. Now, some people would actually use pull-up resistors on the data lines. To be honest with you, it's unneeded. Some people swear that you need to have it. I'm going to be honest with you, I've never once ran into a situation where the data lines needed pull-ups. If you believe in it, by all means, go for it. If you have problems, by all means, throw some resistors in there. But in my experience, it's just not needed, okay? So now that we have that done, we are going to go ahead and sort out some of these other items. Now, the first thing that we're going to need is to add a crystal in here. So if we type crystal, we have lots of different ones here, but we are going to go for a normal everyday crystal. It's going to be a 49S, and we are going to want to put that over here somewhere. I think right there is fine. We'll give this a value of I think 12 megahertz is probably the best for this particular build, because that will help us simplify it. So we have given it 12 megahertz, and we want to connect that now. Now, remember, on these, they will require a capacitor, so we need to add in capacitors. And that's pretty easy to do. Again, I like the RCL, and we're going to go for CUS. And the particular one that I happen to like the most is this one right here, the C050-025X075. And that's just about perfect for most of your modern 0.2 capacitors, 0.2 inch, that is. So we're just going to stick those two right there. And we are going to connect these leads over to them, and then we're going to connect these two. Actually, we need to bring this bus down. We're kind of short on room there, but we can fix that. That's not a problem. Just like everything else, we've got plenty of room. Okay, so we are going to connect this. Well, we got to do it the other way around. That's one of the little quirks about this. If you've already got a net there, you have to connect to the net that you have. So we've connected that to ground. Okay. Now, the next thing that we want to do is go ahead and get this other resistor over here. And we're going to connect that resistor to VCC. And we are going to name this AVR RES. Now, so we got a basic reset. Now, if you don't know anything about AVRs, they have a very interesting thing that they do, is they will auto reset. Now, the next thing that we need to do is to actually start connecting power and ground. So we're going to connect this to power. We're going to connect this to ground, and we can simply pull this over to here, pull this over to 5 volt, and then pull that to 5 volt as well. And the reason why we do that is because on the AVRs, obviously we have power and ground, but we also have this auxiliary power and ground, and that is for the analog to digital inputs. Now, we probably won't need those, but if so, we want to give them some type of reference. And, of course, that means that we also need to have the reference line hooked up, and also the power to the analog converter, the DAC, I guess, or the ADC. We want to make sure it has power and that it has a reference, and that's the reason why we hook those up like so. Now, the next thing that we need to start worrying about is, before we touch any of this, we need to start worrying about, first off, making some room over here, because, man, we got stuff everywhere. But that'll just take a moment. Let's make this a little bit neater. And, of course, I don't have these in any particular order, but... stick them here. Now, the next thing that we need to start thinking about is how we are going to interface these. And it's pretty straightforward, but we're going to have to come up with some type of logic. So let me think about this for just a moment. Okay, we're back. So the next thing, like I mentioned, is we have to figure out how we are going to interface to the AVR. And the easiest way of doing this would be to actually use a flip-flop. Now, we don't need a preset, so we can actually take this preset and connect that to ground, or I'm sorry, to power. Now, I don't have a bus brought out here, so I'm just going to use a very simple way of doing this. We can name this VCC. And that will connect it to VCC. Now, we also need to make this a flip-flop, so that means that we need to pull the data out and then from the reverse output and plug it back into the D, so that every time that we clock this, the data that's on D will be what is displayed on the output port. And then it will be knotted, which will give that back to the data port, and when we clock again, it will change. So in other words, let's assume that this is going to start off as a zero, okay? I'm sorry, that this is going to start off as a zero, so because we're going to clear this, we're going to hook it up to the reset. So by doing so, the data out will be a zero, but the not of that will be a one. That one will get fed back into D, and then when we clock D, or clock the flip-flop, it's going to put a one here and a zero here, and then that will feed back into D, and when we clock it, we now have a zero and a one back in, clock it again, and then we get a one, and over and over and over and over. But the reason why we're going to do it this way is because we need to take control of the bus as soon as possible. And the way that we do that is simply to, you know, essentially put an interrupt out. Now, we need to interrupt both the we don't necessarily need to put an interrupt out for the Z80, but we do need to give some type of interrupt to the AVR. But we're also going to have a separate circuit here for when the AVR has data to send to the Z80, and it will use the same circuit because, quite frankly, it's easy to do so. And we can provide an interrupt here so that the Z80 knows that, oh, IO is requesting something. So, should be pretty simple. Of course, we don't necessarily need that. And we may actually do away with this, because what we can do is we can divide the clock down and actually give ourselves 6 megahertz. And now that I think about it, that's actually a better way of doing this, because we can shoot a interrupt straight from the AVR itself. So we'll plan on doing that. But we will use this to basically signal that there's data out there on the bus, and to essentially halt the computer for the time being. So what we can do is actually use this pin on the wait line so that we basically buy ourselves some time. By putting a wait state in there, we're giving the IO device, in this particular case the AVR, a chance to process data and do what it needs to do before it releases that signal. So that may be what we do. I think that's probably going to be what we do. But then we also have to figure out how to clear that data once it's done. So, having said that, we've got a pretty good start here. And I think that we the next thing that we need to do is start looking at putting these pins to some type of use. So, having said that, let's take a look at these. Let's see what pins are here. Now, I see we have RX and TX, and we're probably going to want those for some type of USB connectivity or serial connectivity. So we'll probably have to keep those separate. Now, we need a total of 16 lines just for the address, and we also need 8 lines for the data. So having said that, I think the easiest thing that we can do is to use these pins here. We can use 22 through 29, 1 through 8, and 33 through 40. I think that's probably going to be our best bet. And the reason why I say that is because we can use these pins here as the low address, these pins here as the high address, and then, use these pins here as the low and high address, and then this is the data. And that should give us a pretty good start on plugging this information out there. Or maybe this is data at the low address, high address. We'll figure it out. It's not that complicated. So let's go ahead and do that. Let's go ahead and bring this bus down. And we're going to go ahead and bring it across. Now, let's start plugging the data lines in here. So we need to leave these open. Dang it. We really do need to leave those open. And we really need those for the SD interface, although we could probably bit bang that. Not really a good option here. But we can figure it out. It's not that hard. So let's just plan on bit banging the data through a makeshift SPI. So we're going to go ahead and turn these into the data pins. So we'll have data 0, data 1, data 2, that's data 7. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and do the rest of these and get the labels on there, and then I will be back. Okay, we're back. So a couple things. I did some house cleaning. First off, is I labeled all the resistors as being 10K, because 10K is a very good value to use for resistors. So after that, the first thing that I did was I determined which pins I wanted to be the address pins. I chose port A and port B as being the high and the low bytes of the address lines. Port C I chose to be data, and then port D I actually used as a mixed signal. So obviously we are going to want some way of communicating with the outside world, so I chose to keep TX and RX, which is transmit and receive. Now, we are going to need access to the memory and the write, and the reason for that is so that we can upload our code into the RAM chips upon boot. You can't really do much if you don't have code in there, and RAM does not store memory permanently. Whenever you turn the computer off, it goes bye-bye. So we definitely want those two so that we can write data to the RAM chips upon boot up. We want control of the reset pin because we want to be able to reset the Z80 after the initial boot. So the reason for that being is because we want to essentially boot the AVR, set the reset line low, load the code into memory using the memory request, the write, the data lines, and the address lines, and then once that is complete, we can set that value to high, and it will allow the Z80 to go in there and do whatever code it needs. We also need to be able to tell the AVR that there's some type of code out there, so we have a IO chip select or chip-enabled, which is developed by this circuit here. So obviously we're setting the preset to high because we're not going to need to preset anything. We are clocking this with the IO request line, which simply toggles the clock, which again takes the output from not Q and plugs it back into D and then spits out the value, which initially it'll be low, and then after that it will go, if we clock the data line, it will actually go high. I'm probably going to have to do some work on this, and the reason for that being is because, quite frankly, I don't think this is going to work, and because there's no way to actually set this high. It's going to start off in a low state, so I'm still going to have to do a little bit of thinking about that for just a moment, and I'll probably end up using one of these NOT gates in order to do that. I can set the NOT, and then at that point it will plug that data out there. But we also need to be able to clear this, and of course that means that we need a clear line, which we've done here. So that's pretty much taken up every single pin on the Z80. Now we're sacrificing a read, but realistically we don't need the read line. You know, if the Z80 is trying to read data from the AVR, the simple assertion of the IO coupled with the particular address that it's addressing here on the address bus will tell us that it's trying to read from a particular address. We can set up certain registers so that, or virtual registers within the AVR, if you will, that will know that, okay, that's actually asking us to read, and we can actually assess that value and determine what our next step is, and then either read data from the data bus or to put the data onto the data bus. Now, having said that, it's kind of going to be a tricky situation because we're going to have to manage this data somehow or another. I'm not sure how. One thing that we might be able to do is to actually read the data in from the port, say, okay, it's giving us a port value to this address, and then it's telling us, okay, we want you to tell us what the input from the serial port is. Okay, well that's easy. Then we would simply take over bus lines through the use of the bus request, and then we could put that data onto the RAM chip in a particular location so that then the Z80 just turns around and reads from memory. I'm still playing with this. This is kind of a neat little way of doing it. I've never actually interfaced to a AVR before, so it's kind of new to me. It's pretty interesting, I'm not going to lie. But we'll have to play with it to see what else we can come up with. But that's a general idea for now. So I think on the next episode, and the reason why I say that is because I think we've been going for a pretty good amount of time here, we're going to iron out some of the fine details on exactly how this works. But I do want to go over the clock circuit before we get out of here. First off, I'm using this as a clock divider. I'm using the flip-flop as a clock divider. We set clear to high because we're not worried about clearing it. We have to feed the clock pin with some type of clock, and of course we're going to be using the output from the AVR's clock oscillator here in order to clock this, and then we can actually take that, and the D line is being fed from the NOT Q, and of course the preset's being pulled high to VCC, which means every single time this transitions, it's up down, it's going to change the state from either up to down or from down to up, you know, 1 to 0 or 0 to 1, if you will, and that creates our 6 megahertz clock circuit. So it basically just divides down that clock, which we are then feeding into the Z80 to give it a way to actually, you know, have a standalone clock for itself, but at the same time without having to add more components than what we absolutely need. So at this point, what we have is we have the AVR and the Z80, two RAM chips. We have a dual flip-flop, a single 74HC04, and a single 74HC32, and then a total of 6 resistors. So with just that alone, we have essentially created the basis for a Z80 system. Now we may end up needing to add a few more chips to this, and that's fine. Even Grant Searle's design, I think, was 7 chips, and we're probably going to have another one. But you have to remember, he was actually using a 6850, and we're trying to make that a little bit simpler by interfacing to this, which gives us a lot more options. We can do, you know, complex math, all kinds of things that we can do on this. Another option that we have, of course, you know, it would take a little bit more work, would be to remove one of these and replace it with, let's say, a 28C256, which we definitely have. And if that were the case, then what we could do is set the bit lock on that so that it could not be written to. And then we could do away with A8 through A15, because at that point we don't actually have to load that into memory. So, you know, it's some pretty neat ideas here. This is just, you know, a primer for how do we design a system. You know, you have to play around, you have to mess with ideas, and you have to see exactly how you want this to function. So having said that, this may change quite a bit, you know, in the next episode. I may come up with some other ideas that I want to try out instead. And you have to craft this in a way that is going to lead you to something that's going to work. Now, having said that, you're going to know pretty early on, as long as you know a little bit about the processor itself, whether or not your prototype is even going to be remotely functional. So if you don't know about the Z80, if you don't understand the way it works, my best advice would be to really dig into the data sheets, dig into the posts that other people have made, watch other videos, read every single bit of information that you can. I know it's very in-depth, I know that there's a lot of things that you don't understand, but you're never going to understand until you actually take the time to read the material and understand a little bit about the architecture that you're trying to use. It's by far the easiest architecture for the hobbyist to use, as far as I'm concerned, and much easier than the 8080, much easier than the 6502, much easier than the 6800, much easier than essentially any other processor out there. And if you're willing to take the time to learn about it, you'll find that you can do some really amazing things with this processor. And of course, with the AVR, it is going to give us quite a bit more room to play with. So I hope that you enjoyed the video. If you have any questions, ask them below. And of course, we'll see you next time.
So that's it for today, guys. I hope that you enjoyed the video. I, you know, kind of shot this from the hip, to be honest with you. I'm kind of doing that here lately. But the whole idea behind this is to give you guys an idea as far as the process that I go through whenever I'm designing any electronics project. I had, like I had mentioned before, a individual that had asked about this as one of the comments to one of my previous videos, and I thought that this would make for a really interesting series. So I'm planning on having at least 2, maybe 3 or 4 more videos, you know, to this in this series. The idea is that we're going to take a couple videos in order to draw up our schematics, and then after that we're going to actually take those schematics and turn them into a board file, you know, that we can generate Gerbers from. And then at that point, you know, potentially order those Gerbers and or boards, if you will, and then at that point we can build it and then start building some software for the AVR. So it's going to be a work in progress. I plan on releasing this to the wild. It's just kind of a here you go, have fun with it. Probably not going to be hosting much of this material on my website. This is going to be, for the most part, kind of a YouTube thing. So if you have any questions, feel free to, you know, drop them below. Outside of that, obviously subscribe. And then also, I was going to let you know, if you do want to check out the website, that address is retrodepot.net. I want to thank you for watching the video, and if you have anything at all that you want to see, be sure and let me know, because I'm feeling kind of, you know, video happy at the moment. I want to shoot some more videos and get them up. So again, thank you for staying until the end, and we will see you in the next episode.